Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. States and retailers are moving at breakneck speed to remove the Confederate flag from the public's eye, but is this just distracting us from the larger discussion? The Affordable Care Act has given the FBI new tools to crack down on Medicare fraud, and they recently announced a massive scheme involving dozens of doctors all over the country. And Fox News has broken up with Sarah Palin. Are they trying to silence the stupid talk before the election gets underway? More on that in tonight's backstory. And that's what's coming up tonight. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warning, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
The Republican field is overcrowded right now with wannabe presidential candidates. But once we hit debate season, this field is going to narrow down to a few finalists, weeding out the worst of the worst. People like Ted Cruz or Donald Trump are going to be distant memories, and we'll be left with Republicans who are just barely sane enough to actually be elected president. Now, if we want to get a glimpse of what could happen should one of these Republicans actually win the White House in 2016, the best place to look is at states that are suffering under Republican rule. In Wisconsin, where Republican Governor Scott Walker still hasn't made any grand announcement about his intentions, job growth has been among the worst in the Midwest. Walker believed that his assault on public teachers and unions and his tax cuts for the wealthy would be a boon for the state economy, but so far, they've only succeeded in making things much, much worse for the dairy state. Now Walker's following in the footsteps of Florida's Governor Rick Scott by forcing people on public assistance to submit to drug testing, a move that actually ended up costing Florida taxpayers $1.5 million. In Kansas, Republican Governor Sam Brownback has sent the state back into the dark ages with draconian laws aimed at reducing the freedom of women and minorities. His plan to lower taxes on businesses ended up causing a massive loss of jobs, plunging his state's economy into an abyss. And his plan to get the state out of this crisis? It's not to reinstate the taxes on those businesses, but to raise taxes on the lower and middle class workers in the state. The elite of Kansas are going to continue to see their tax burdens fall, while the people who are struggling to make ends meet will have an even harder time just surviving in Brownback's Kansas. Oklahoma has found itself in an identical economic dilemma when Republican Governor Mary Fallon decided to cut taxes for businesses and wealthy citizens, and they've now had to tap into the state's financial reserves, and they've scaled back basic government services in order to keep the government functioning without the additional tax revenue. And it's the same in most Republican-controlled states like Florida, Georgia, Louisiana, and of course Texas. The states are considered to be laboratories for democracy. What this means is that they're where politicians try out ideas before pitching them on a national level. But in these cases, Republican governors are trying out ideas that have already failed on the national level. When Ronald Reagan imposed his trickle-down economic policy on the country, unemployment skyrocketed, the deficit ballooned, and the country was sent into a massive recession almost immediately. So why would these Republicans think that their trickle-down policies would produce different results? And more importantly, why won't they try what some of the more liberal states and cities are doing? For example, raising the minimum wage. When some cities began implementing a $15 an hour minimum wage, business leaders cried about the sky that was about to fall on them. But do you know what happened instead? They began making more money once they started paying their workers a living wage. They began to hire more people to keep up with demand, and these areas began seeing revitalization due to increased consumer activity, which in turn generated more tax revenue for the state. And not just in America, in areas of Canada where the wages have been raised, they're seeing the exact same economic boom that a few progressive areas in the United States are already experiencing. Money flows from the bottom, not from the top. And that's why the trickle-down economic lie that Republicans are so keen on selling to us is such a disaster. But that's what we can expect from a Republican president and from any of the candidates that are currently running for office. We'll get more attacks on unions, more attacks on education, more attacks on workers, more attacks on the poor, more budget cuts for social programs, and more tax breaks for the wealthy. Oh, and let's not forget, more endless war. In fact, former Vice President Dick Cheney is once again making the rounds of the Sunday morning talk shows to tell us that the Iraq War was one of the best foreign policy decisions in a generation. The talking points of a war-hungry geriatric who once shot his friend in the face because he mistook him for a bird mean relatively little in today's political discourse, but it's what Cheney is doing behind the scenes that should have all of us deeply concerned. According to an article in Salon.com, Dick Cheney's working behind the scenes these days with his group, the Alliance for a Strong America, which is a coalition of 501c4 groups that promote the use of military power for nearly every situation imaginable. Their goal is to disseminate talking points and educate the public about the benefits of flexing our military muscle to keep the rest of the world in check. And the group has plenty of money to accomplish their goals. The defense industry has pumped several million dollars into the group, but due to their classification status, most of those donors remain nameless. One thing that we do know is that every Republican candidate, with the exception of Rand Paul, has spoken in recent months about the Iraq War and how it was the right move to make at the time. They've defended Cheney and Bush at every possible turn, and it's because they know that Cheney still holds a tremendous amount of political power. Now, he may not be an asset on the campaign trail, but he has money, and he knows who to get more money, but only if you're willing to play by his rules. And that's what's happening right now. Cheney's appearing in the media as a not-so-subtle reminder to Republican candidates that he's still here and he's still calling the shots. And the next Republican candidate will be taking his foreign policy orders directly from Cheney and his organization for endless war. But as always, as one conservative nut from the past reemerges, that means we have to boot someone else off the stage, and sadly, that someone is Sarah Palin. Fox News has decided not to renew Sarah Palin's contract, effectively ending the relationship that the network developed during the 2008 presidential campaign. According to Politico, the breakup was amicable, and both parties agreed that it was simply time to move on. There's nothing about this story that actually makes any sense, though, at least not on the surface. See, Fox News is the voice of crazy. Sarah Palin can't stop saying stupid things when you put a microphone in front of her face, so it's the perfect match. We're entering campaign season, and Fox decides to cut one of their biggest draws? I don't think so. Here's what's really happening. Fox News understands that Sarah Palin is a liability. Yes, she has a lot of money in her Sarah PAC that she's spending on Republican candidates, and yes, there are actually still some desperate Republicans out there that want her to come speak at their events. But Palin is too inconsistent and far too incoherent to be of any real help for a Republican candidate. Fox News is well aware of the fact that Palin struggles to put sentences together, and when she is successful at making a coherent string of words, the sentence form turns into something highly inflammatory or downright insulting. And when we have a Republican field that is filled with people like Donald Trump, Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio, and Carly Fiorina, Fox cannot afford to have anyone out there piling on the stupid, and that's exactly what Sarah Palin does. Fox correctly decided that the current GOP field is dumb enough, and they don't need Palin taking the conversation down to a level that even their audience is too intelligent to hear. We'll be right back.
Ring of Fire is always on. Radio, YouTube, social media, and news. The news stories that matter to progressives are always available at ringoffireradio.com, along with commentary, interviews, and so much more. ringoffireradio.com.
The Confederate flag is finally coming down all over the South, and it should. The flag's a symbol of oppression and bigotry, and it only gained popularity once white supremacist groups began to use it as their symbol. But doesn't it seem a little weird that these diehard Southern Republicans were suddenly so willing to remove this flag? Now, they've fought for years to keep this flag flying, and for a group that refuses to admit that the South Carolina shootings were racially motivated, they all jumped at the opportunity to remove the Confederate flag. There's a lot more going on here, and I'm joined now by Democratic strategist and president of New Heights Communications, Christy Setzer. Christy, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks. Good to be here.
So, look, we have Republican governors all over the South. We have massive retailers all over the country pulling down the Confederate flag, which is a great response. I mean, you know, this is something that needed to happen a long time ago, and it's a very good thing that this has finally happened. Why do you think we suddenly are now seeing so much cooperation from these Republicans that had put up so much a fight to keep the flag up?
Right. So, you know, there's a cynical part of me that says that they are doing this because it is much harder to do other things like, say, talk about gun control or talk about racism or talk about the pervasive rise in hate groups in their party right now. This is actually pretty easy because it's a symbol. Yes, and it looks like they are doing something where they could potentially piss off the most extreme parts of their party. And so people like Nikki Haley have of course gotten lauded for her bravery, you know, talked about as potential vice presidential material just for the fact that she was willing to pull down the flag in South Carolina. And I think that's a little overstated. I think the bigger point here is this, not to totally diminish it, is something easy for them to do.
Well, it is. And, you know, like we said, this is a great gesture. It's something that's long overdue. But with the fight that these people had put up for so long to keep the flag flying, I mean, I live down here in the South, and the bumper stickers are everywhere that literally say, keep the flag flying. So, yeah, this easily could alienate, you know, those folks who drive around with those bumper stickers. But at the same time, you know, perhaps maybe they think it's going to endear them to the African-American community, saying, look, I'm stepping up. I'm doing something on race. The Republicans are not as bad, you know, as you might think we are. Do you think it's going to gain them any kind of political points, or do you think people kind of see through the charade here?
Well, I mean, I don't think it's going to get them many African-American votes. I think those votes are probably long gone. I think it's possible that it does get them points from moderates. I do think that's possible, because the people who have stood up on this, the reaction is split. I mean, you look at somebody like Jeb Bush, who has actually been pretty good on this issue, you know, in his home state when he was governor, and he gets a pretty mixed response from his own party for the issues in which he's unwilling to take a stand, say this, immigration, et cetera, where he's not seemed like a crazy extremist. You know, to some extent, they might get some moderate votes. I don't think that they're going to get any liberal votes, certainly. But, you know, and I don't think that it actually loses them too much from the extreme wing of their party either.
Right. Because you're not going to have those extreme people saying, well, I'm going to go vote for Bernie Sanders, I guess. You know, that doesn't make sense
right.
for them
that's
either.
That's not the calculation. Right.
No. But, you know, you hit on something earlier, which is a really great point. And Jeb Bush also brings us back. We have the NRA out there that wants people to talk about everything except gun control. I mean, they're even okay with us talking about the problem, you know, of race and oppression in America. They especially want us to be talking about the flag. Now, the NRA had a lot of pull with Jeb Bush when he was governor of Florida, where we live, and, you know, it put a ton of money into him, had him at rallies, events, everything you can name, and they're still, you know, pulling a lot of strings. Is the NRA right now relieved that the conversation has completely shifted away from gun control?
Oh, heck yes. Absolutely. This is a huge win for the NRA. And I will actually say that on this particular issue, it is such an interesting, you know, conflation of both race issues that we've been talking about in our country and the gun control issue that I can sort of see how the gun control specific issue got a little bit shifted aside. Also because it's so clear that Dylann Roof was such a, you know, white supremacist, you know, person that that I think it was actually less in this case about the gun control issue, which, don't get me wrong, I'm all in favor of gun control, than it was about maybe the culture of hate that he's surrounded himself with, and what do you do about that? It's obviously been exacerbated by the fact that he was able to not just get his hands on the gun, but it was actually given a gun on his birthday by his father. So culture of guns exacerbated the problem. But I sort of see in this particular instance that the real issue was, again, the culture of hate that he grew up with and was allowed to find himself as part of.
We've seen a lot of court rulings in the last 2 or 3 years where it is perfectly legal for a potential employer to go through somebody's Facebook feed, go through their tweets, and hire or not hire someone based strictly on, some of their posts. They say, well, this guy has said some outlandish things. We're not going to hire him. So the private industry has been given the green light, to do that in their hiring practices. Now, in terms of gun control, if the federal government decided as part of their background checks, we're going to go through and we're going to look at some of your pictures. And if we see you standing in front of 8 Confederate flags, posed with 2 guns like this, maybe you're not the kind of guy that needs to own another firearm. What would the backlash be if the government started acting like private industry here? Because private industry does it in hiring. What if the government did it for gun control?
Yeah, the private industry would be reaction would be swift and enormous if government tried to do something like that. And I would actually in some ways sort of understand the point. In some ways, we hold government to a higher standard, or at least I think we should. Obviously it would feed into every conservative fear about big government being in your business, trying to take away your guns. And all of that. And they wouldn't be 100% wrong if that kind of story got out.
Right. I mean, you do border on invasion of privacy at that point. Well, I don't even know that that's bordering. That really isn't very clear. We're getting into your personal life at this point. But it is an interesting juxtaposition because, according to the Republicans, the private industry, everything they do, that's essentially like a Bible for them. If they do it, it's correct. If government does it, that is wrong. And so when we come back to both of the issues, gun control and racism, huge, huge problems in America. The gun control is not as big of an issue this time because there was so many racial overtones with this. So where does the conversation go from here? I mean, the Confederate flag has dominated the headlines for a week and a half at this point. Racism has. Gun control, it's popping up here and there. But do we keep at it, or do we try to tackle one issue at a time here?
Well, I mean, there's been a lot of people who've said, look, we should claim it as a victory that that these flags are coming down, that that companies as big as Walmart and Etsy, Amazon, et cetera, are taking down and preventing the sale of Confederate flags, and that, okay, is an interesting conversation to have, and I suppose on some level does seem like progress. I think the danger would be for progressives or anybody who's having the let's take down the flag fight to think that that's the end goal. It's so not. It can't be. I mean, if we're just talking about the taking down of a symbol and grappling with what that means, we've really not gone far enough. And so I think it's really easy for people on both sides of the aisle to think, well, we've accomplished something, like let's wash our hands and be done with it and move on to the next thing. And I really hope that doesn't happen.
There was a study in the Washington Post the other day that said that this new generation, these millennials, that everybody thinks, a couple generations from now, racism is going to die out. But it turns out they're actually just as racist proportionally to the current generations. So, this myth that it's going to die out in a few generations is just that. It's a myth. But we do see that racism is taught, and I think that's what this Washington Post report is telling us. So do you think that by removing the flags, by keeping this discussion out there, we can help reduce those numbers with the millennial generation and the generations after it?
Well, I mean, the point is in having, your government take down its state flag that represents, this hated symbol, the symbol of treason and, hatred, et cetera. It is government setting the example and saying, this isn't something that we want to remember in a favorable light anymore. And so I think that does set a nice example for kids who are growing up now. Do I think it's enough? Of course not. And do I think that, you know, it's going to lessen the number of people who have their own personal Confederate flags, say, that maybe are flying in their own, you know, in their own home or neighborhood? No, I don't. And in fact, I think in some ways, it's going to make people a little bit even more resistant, because as we talked about, it sort of plays into a bit of that narrative, oh, government's telling me how to do stuff. And I think that, you know, that rises up resistance. But, you know, so it's hard to say what the ultimate impact is, but I do think it's a good first step. I just think it's only a first step.
Absolutely. Christy Setzer, New Heights Communications, thank you so much for joining us, and we will check back in with you in the near future. Thank you.
Sounds great. Thanks so much.
While it does have its share of flaws, the Affordable Care Act is actually a very powerful piece of legislation that has given regulatory agencies the power they need to go after people who are ripping off American taxpayers. And this new power has yielded some fairly impressive results by uncovering some of the most egregious cases of Medicare fraud that we've seen in a long time. And I have attorney Will Atkinson with me now to talk about this. Well, at the end of last week, we saw the Supreme Court uphold the provision of the Affordable Care Act that saved, you know, the subsidies. But with the Affordable Care Act in the news, I think it's important to mention the fact that the Affordable Care Act has given what's called the Medicare Task Force more teeth to investigate claims of fraud. And as the FBI and the Department of Justice recently announced, healthcare, or Medicare fraud, I should say, is incredibly common, and for the criminals pulling it off, it is a very lucrative business. Tell us about this latest FBI bust that happened.
That's right. Last week, the Department of Justice announced a $712 million fraud scheme that was busted. It was the largest takedown in the eight-year history of this Medicare Fraud Strike Force, which is a joint initiative of the DOJ and HHS. And it was the largest criminal healthcare fraud takedown in the history of the Department of Justice. Healthcare fraud is distressingly common. $1 out of every $6 in the United States economy is spent on healthcare. And as Attorney General Loretta Lynch noted during the press conference, whenever there's money, you're going to find criminals. And that's what happened.
Well, you know, you have doctors who already make very good money. I mean, not too many doctors out there struggling to make ends meet, especially not ones that are established. And so for this latest bust, you know, we're seeing, you know, a case in Miami where you have, you know, a couple dozen doctors busted. You got 73 in Dallas. You know, I mean, these are people who are already making money, but it's not enough. And I think Loretta Lynch actually hit it on the head where she said, wherever there's money, there's fraud, because wherever there's money, there's greed. And greed breeds fraud. And that's what we've seen. You know, walk us through a little bit, a few of these examples of what exactly these doctors and nurses and other healthcare facilities were actually doing.
That's right, Farron. In Miami, there were dozens of defendants who were arrested in this bust. They were charged with $263 million in false billings of Medicare. And the examples are just disgusting. They're ripping off hospices. In Miami, there was a mental health facility that charged Medicare for $64 million falsely. And they were taking Alzheimer's patients and individuals with dementia. They were just moving them around and charging Medicare for intensive, quote unquote, psychotherapy services. And it was completely false. And they were just lining their pockets. There's more.
This is, you know, one of the things we've seen. Our governor down here in Florida, let me put it this way. He was president of a healthcare company that committed the single largest Medicare fraud in history. And what his company did is what a lot of these doctors and facilities have done. They would upcode patients saying like, okay, we performed a CT scan when really all they came in for was a sore throat. We never performed the scan. So we get the money from Medicare, you know, as if we had done those services. Then you have other instances here where they say like, oh, well, we need to buy, you know, 100 wheelchairs for our hospice. Okay, well, we're going to bill Medicare. They pay it. No wheelchairs at all.
Yeah.
or they buy them and they sell them to other places. I mean, this is absolutely, as you pointed out, disgusting behavior, because these people do need care. They do need help. And these, you know, facilities are absolutely taking advantage of them every day.
These are vulnerable populations. These are people who depend on healthcare services, and the fraudsters and criminals out there just see these people as ATM machines. You mentioned wheelchairs. In Los Angeles, the defendants were charged with $23 million in false billing. That included billing for 1,000 of these expensive wheelchairs that were sometimes not even provided, but they still submitted the bill. This is a nationwide problem, and it was great to see this announcement. This is a victory for not only taxpayers, but the beneficiaries of healthcare programs and anyone who might need these services in the future.
This strike force, they have recovered, I think, close to about $15 billion in healthcare fraud just in the last 7 years. I mean, that's all they've been around is 7 years. $15 billion. Now that's small considering what Wall Street has ripped us off, but that $15 billion, excuse me, is taxpayer money, because this is Medicare fraud. So, you know, I mean, this is money they're stealing from us.
That's right. This is a very successful program. You know, you always hear people whining about government waste, but this program, for every dollar spent on it, it's returned $8. It has an 800% ROI for taxpayer money. You mentioned the $15 billion returned. That's from 2,300 defendants who have been charged just in the last 5 years, is the $15 billion by the DOJ. But this has been a remarkably successful program. And during the press conference, they talked about the DOJ's enhanced data analytics and forensics accounting ability. But they also noted that many of the cases came from False Claims Act, which is when individual whistleblowers come forward and volunteer information. So it's a combined effort of the DOJ, HHS, and local and federal law enforcement officials, and then also whistleblowers who cooperate and provide information to stop these criminals.
Well, and you know, there is an incentive for these whistleblowers to come forward. I mean, they face absolutely huge retaliation from their employers if they come forward, or if they present this case to the company and say, look, I think we're ripping the government off. You know, countless stories about them being retaliated against. But if they do come forward with the government and it proves to be a legitimate claim of fraud, you know, these people do get a share of what is recovered. So, you know, if anybody's watching this, I absolutely encourage you, if you see your employer doing anything, you know, illegal, come forward with it, you know, get an attorney, because if they try to retaliate, you want to be legally protected. But, you know, more importantly, we got to keep corporations honest. We got to keep the government running smoothly so that we don't have, you know, the 1% out there of doctors and nurses who are, you know, ripping us off by $15 billion over 7 years. So, I mean, what advice would you give in about the minute we have left here?
That's right. I mean, the medical, it's enough to make you cynical, I'll put it that way. But with healthcare fraud, if you know about fraud and you work in a company or healthcare facility and you're aware of it, talk to a whistleblower attorney. You may be eligible for 15 to 25%, up to 30% of any recovery by the government. That's what I would recommend if you're aware of healthcare fraud. If you're a healthcare consumer, read your bills. Protect your identification information, but absolutely read your bill. And hopefully, we know the bill is boring, but hopefully it's boring and there's no surprises. But people would be shocked to learn at how prevalent healthcare fraud is in America today.
Absolutely. Well, at least we know we have a DOJ that's finally getting out there doing something about it. And Will, thank you for telling us this story today. We appreciate it.
Thanks, Baron.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can always get the news that the corporate media won't cover on our website at ringoffireradio.com and on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftTV. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.